It's beginning to rain, rain, rain in the voice of our Father. Sing, whosoever will come drink of this water. I promise to pour my spirit out on your sons and your daughters. If you're thirsty and dry, look up to the sky. It's beginning.
Hello, friends. This is Tex Mars, inviting you to worship with us today at Bible Home Church, coming to you from Austin, Texas. How wonderful a day it is. The sun is shining. We have a lot of deer in our backyard here at the ministry. There were about, 12 deer, 10 or 12 just a while ago. One with the sizable antlers, not huge. But to every day they congregate here in my backyard to look out the windows, even as I'm recording in our studio, and you see all these deer and three or four squirrels cavorting about. A lot of birds out there. All of these creatures just bring you back to God, don't they? What a beautiful world He's created. If it's that pretty here, can you imagine in heaven what awaits us? Wow. But something is very important, friends. It's important that you don't get wrapped up in false teachings and heresies while you're right here on earth. Because they exist, and I'm telling you, they are everywhere, the false teachers and the evil doers trying to make you believe lies. Did you know the Pharisees didn't disappear with the end of the first century? I mean, when the apostles, Peter and John and Paul and the others passed away and went on to be with the Lord, passed away, that is, from human existence into glorious immortal existence, the Pharisees didn't pass away. The Pharisaic religion has existed all these many years. And today, the Pharisees are taking over Christian churches. Messianic Judaism is a hit in today's Christian world. You go into Christian bookstores, there's books telling you how to obey the halakha, the Jewish laws. They say you've got to do your kol nidre oath and obey all the Jewish laws and heed such high holy days as Yom Kippur, and it's ridiculous. The Pharisees of the days of Jesus are now having their revenge. They're taking over the Christian establishment. And we're going to expose that heresy today. It's an accursed gospel. Paul said, Galatians chapter 1, he feared for the church. And I fear for the church today. And you should too. But the question is, might you be wrapped up in this Phariseeism and don't even know it? You think I'm talking about legalism, don't you? Well, I am, but only at a small degree. Of course they're legalistic. But it's more than that. It's a worship of things past rather than things present. It's a worship of the symbol rather than the substance. It's a worship of the traces rather than the reality. It's a worship of the shadow rather than the material reality that is Jesus Christ and the spiritual reality. It's a false spirituality. And millions are being deceived by Pharisee religion today. You thought that it went away. You thought it's just old historical legendary stuff from the Bible. No, no, no. Judaism is Phariseeism, and it has attacked our churches, and Christian leaders are falling head over heels for it. Rarely do they read Galatians and understand it. In fact, I'm not sure they have ever read the book of Galatians. If they did, they would see the truth, because Galatians clashes with what they're doing. we're going to really get into that. We're going to have a whole series starting today, The Revenge of the Pharisees. Now, before we do that, we'd love to hear from you. If you're able to send us love gifts, wonderful. If you want us to pray for you, that would be fantastic. If you just have a comment, you might have a criticism. I hope not, but if you have one, I'll read it. I don't know if I'll agree with you, but I might. You might have a praise item for us to know about. You know, you might want to thank God and just want us to know about it. Some people send us letters and say, text, I just want to tell you the wonderful thing that happened in my life that God has done. See, I think when you give God praise, broadcast it. Tell everybody. You'll be thankful you did. And doesn't God really deserve the praise? Now, usually we have some beautiful music, and we have some beautiful music today. And I want to tell you just a little bit about it. You know, a lot of people wonder if Elvis Presley is in heaven today. I've been asked that question. And I remember I criticized some of the behavior and conduct of Elvis Presley. And boy, I remember in Little Rock, Arkansas, the owner of a Christian radio station there took me to task. It was a woman. And boy, she was mad at me. She loved Elvis Presley. I've thought it over many years. And I've come to the conclusion that Elvis Presley was a very sad case. His mother and dad were Christian believers. They raised him in Christianity. And, you know, this is true. I've read about this because I wanted to know about Elvis. I always thought he had a voice like an angel. There's no doubt God gave this man great talent. And, you know, they said that from the time he was a little kid, the thing he loved most was to hear gospel music in church. And gospel quartets said that Elvis, just as a young boy of 10, would come sometimes by himself, would come from home there in, I think it was, Tupelo, Mississippi. And there at a high school auditorium, some old gospel quartets would come in once a month and sing. And little Elvis would always be there. And he just adored those guys. And one of them, I think it was J.D. Sumner and the Stamps quartet, gospel quartet, said that little Elvis came up to him after one of the concerts there of this quartet, went up to Mr. Sumner and said, "Mr. Sumner, boy, I sure like your suit," because Elvis was real poor. You know, he probably didn't even have a suit that he could wear to church. "And I sure like your suit." And Mr. Sumner said, "Well, thank you, young man." Didn't even know he was going to turn out to be Elvis Presley. And Elvis said, "How many suits do you have? You know, if you have a suit like that, you must be rich. You must have a whole closet full of suits." And later on in life, Elvis reminded him of that. And Elvis invited him to sing on some of his albums, him and his group. And they said that when Elvis was asked, "What is your favorite music?" he always said, "I like Christian gospel." Nevertheless, Elvis, as we know now from his biographers, got involved with prescription drugs and really just went downhill for a long while there. He backslid. He was a Christian who knew what was right and backslid. Now, we cannot honor his backslid way of life. We can't honor what he was when he went to Las Vegas and all of that. And was really a heathen. I'm not going to honor that. So now the question comes back. Is Elvis in heaven today? I don't know. That's up to God. If he was truly saved, I believe he was. He is in heaven. Now, you know, the Bible says that some people, you know, you might just say, used to use an old Texas, East Texas where I come from, old saying, some people get to heaven just by the skin of their teeth. Actually, the Bible says, so as by fire. Some people don't have any rewards when they get to heaven. They have heaven, but they don't have all the crowns that they could have. You see, I believe there's different, I wouldn't call them degrees or whatever in heaven, different compartments or levels or whatever, but I do know this. God will reward some people more than he rewards others. And I think we're going to be surprised. Some of the people we think were the greatest of Christians will not have any rewards at all, hardly, in heaven. And others that you didn't think would have anything are going to really be acclaimed as godly people up there. You can't always judge by appearance, you know. But back to Elvis. The question is he going to be in heaven? I don't know. I pray so. I hope so. I fear he may not be. But I know one thing. God did give him that voice. And you know, friends, you and I are responsible for the gifts that God gives us. Now, you might say, I don't have any gifts. Oh, yes, you do. You might have a gift of hospitality. People just like to be around you. They like to meet you. They like to talk to you. You might have just a gift of mercy. You have sympathy when people get hurt. There's people you could visit in a hospital and pray with. There's neighbors when they get into terrible difficulties and they lose loved ones or any kind of calamities in their life. You could comfort them. That's a gift too. Just a gift of understanding. People can talk to you. You can be a counselor. Maybe you can be a good parent, a good mother, a good father, a good son or daughter. That's a gift because there's so many that don't seem to have that gift. A good husband, a good wife, a good cook, a good housekeeper, a good provider, if you go out into the work world. You have a gift. Some people can sing. I'm not the greatest singer. I'd love to be. Wanda says I should sing some songs on the radio sometime, but I'm afraid I'd embarrass myself. But I might just try it once. See, I know I have friends on Bible Home Church. I might just try a song or two. But I know that's not my greatest gift. Some people can sing a lot better than me. Elvis could. That's for sure. We're going to play an Elvis song. We're going to start playing some Elvis gospel songs. Now I know some of you are going to write me and say, oh, he wasn't any good. He was a terrible person. You shouldn't do that. You're glorifying him. Listen, I don't glorify Elvis Presley. In fact, with any song we play here, it's not meant to glorify the artist, the one singing it. I want you to understand that. You know, I don't really get into the lives of these people. Do you? I don't know. Every once in a while, somebody will write me about somebody that's backslid, that's a Christian gospel singer. And I always feel bad about it. But most of them, I don't know what their lives are. I hear their music, and you know, you really don't know what they do in the privacy of their life. Somebody told me that back in the 50s and 60s, some of these Southern gospel groups got so jaded and so backslid, they said they had drunken parties and sex parties on their buses. They went from church to church. Then they'd go in those churches and just pretend that they were, you know, really holy, sacred Christians. I pray that's not true. I don't know that to be true, but I've heard it. Not all of them, but a good lot of them. But you know, that's to their discredit. God gave them a talent. He gave them angelic voices. If they went out and destroyed by their poor example, I'm so sorry for them. But listen to me. If a man sings with the voice of an angel given him by God, a godly song that glorifies God, and then he goes out and hurts his Christian example, I'm not going to blame the song or the songwriter. I'm not going to say the song was no good. I'm not even going to say his voice was lousy. It wasn't. The song was wonderful. The songwriter probably was inspired by God. The fact that he messed up in his life, I'm sorry for him. That was between him and God. But as far as the song goes, I'll play it. I'll listen to it. Every once in a while, if I know a man really didn't live for Jesus like he should have, I feel bad when I play the song. I do. It's like, you know, I sure wish. And in Elvis' case, if only Elvis had repented before he died and made his profession of faith public and gone out into churches and began to sing as a gospel. He had all the money a man could ever have. He didn't need more money. If only. Friends, that's a good example for you and me, isn't it? And in a strange way, Elvis did have an example. He's the example we should not follow. He's the case example for squandered talent. We're going to play some Elvis songs because the songs are beautiful. His voice, given by God, is beautiful. And let's just hope and pray that he's in heaven. Here's Elvis now singing a song. It's one of my favorite songs, In the Garden. In the Garden. I think you're going to enjoy it. There can be nothing more true than Bible prophecy. In fact, the scriptures call it a sure word. A sure word. It's not of any private interpretation, Peter said, but it came to men of God moved by the Holy Ghost. And you can trust prophecy. And one of the things we discover in Bible prophecy is that there will be a great falling away in the last days. 2 Thessalonians chapter 2. I am here to tell you today and to announce that falling away has already come. It is far advanced. It will bring about the fatal, and I want to emphasize, the fatal seduction of the Christian church. Oh, not the real Christian church, which is the remnant of God, the very elect. But Jesus said, if it were possible, it'll be so seductive, so much like the real thing, so much a clever, cunning counterfeit, it will so subvert Christianity in a subtle, unseen, invisible way that no one will detect the fact that Christianity has become something else. It is called Christianity, but it is not. And what once was the Church of the Living God is become a whorish vehicle for the Antichrist. Oh, that's what we're having today. And, you know, the incredible thing about it is there is a group in our society, and they have always existed, a small number of men and women called Pharisees. They are Jews. And this is exactly the result that they have long sought, fought for, schemed for, plotted toward. And so today, friends, I want to warn you about the revenge of the Pharisees. Jesus put them in their place. And their place was the seat of Satan, which was Jerusalem when Jesus came. He came as their friend, as their Messiah. But they said, and Jesus explained this in his parable, "We will not have this man to rule over us." And they killed him, their Messiah, because they want no Messiah. They wish to be kings of the earth only if they will have a Caesar of their own, a kingdom of their own, a Roman Empire of their own making. They wish, in fact, the Jews have a word for it, tikkun, T-I-K-K-U-N. Look it up in your dictionary. Look it up in your Jewish encyclopedias. If you don't believe me, they intend to repair the world and make it perfect. They, fallible men though they are, say we will bring about tikkun, or the healing, as they claim it will be, repairing of the world, making it perfect. But to do so, they must bring about the Noahide laws and the mass murder of all who oppose this perfect world. Of course, throughout the centuries, we have had many who sought to bring about a perfect world. And especially in the 20th and 21st centuries, revolutionaries came, led mostly by Jews, who said, "We shall bring about a better new world order." And the Pharisees say, "We will bring it about, because only the Jews can make it happen, because we are God on earth collectively. We are in unity the Messiah. We are our own Messiah," says the Jewish Talmud. But there is one great obstacle and a smaller obstacle. The smaller obstacle is Islam. But they will use the muscle power of the U.S. military might to smash Islam, to marginalize it, to move it to the fringes. Only the crazies are Muslims. Don't worry about them. But then comes their greatest opponent, the greatest opponent that Satan has on this planet. For Satan owns this entire planet, except for a little bit of fleshly real estate. Oh, let me go one step further. Spiritual real estate. Call the Christian church. He cannot own you and me if we have Jesus Christ inside. Every man and woman who has Jesus in his heart, listen to me, is the avowed total enemy of the Pharisees and their true God, Satan or Lucifer. Did you just hear what I said? Believe what I'm saying because it's scriptural, not because Tex Mars preaches it to you. I want you to understand something. You are hated, despised, loathed by the Jewish leadership, by the Pharisees, of today. Yes, of today. I don't care how nice, I don't care how tolerant, I don't care how loving you are, they'll hate you even more because your light will so shine before men that that Satan hates it and says, put it out, snuff it out. Kill, kill, kill. Jesus said, you're like a city on a hill, a shining light. No one can put it out. But the Pharisees say, we will snuff you out. We will have our revenge. Jesus prophesied, yes, I will go to the cross, but this very city, Jerusalem, the capital of the Jews, will be destroyed. The people will be massacred. He said that not one stone would be left upon another of the great temple. So when you go to Jerusalem and you see the Wailing Wall, and they claim that's what's left of the great temple of Herod, laugh in their faces. It was destroyed, that temple. And its walls, not one stone was left.
If you're thirsty and dry, look to the sky. It's beginning to rain.
You've been listening to Pastor Tex Mars and Bible Home Church. Please join with us in worship next week as we continue to honor the remarkable Word of God.
It's beginning to rain, 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 in the voice of our Father. Saying, whosoever will come drink of this water, I promise to pour my Spirit out on your sons and your daughters. If you're thirsty and dry, look up to the sky, it's beginning.
Hello, friends. This is Tex Mars, inviting you to worship with us today at Bible Home Church, coming to you from Austin, Texas.
Dear friends, it's great to be with you again. We're going to continue our tremendously important series because it comes right out of the Word of God, entitled Revenge of the Pharisees. Oh, there's a lot about the Pharisees in the Bible. And did you know that Jews today say that Judaism is indeed Phariseeism? So if you go out and you study what Judaism is today, you will then realize and know what Jesus was up against. In other words, what the Orthodox Jewish rabbis teach today is essentially the same that was taught by the rabbis in the days of Jesus. And remember, Jesus said that they traversed the whole earth to find one disciple and then made him twice the devil they were. They were, in fact, of their father, the devil. And Judaism today, being the direct descendant then of Phariseeism, is of the devil. And that's why I am privileged and very delighted to bring to you from the Word of God this series, how the Pharisees are seeking revenge. And amazingly, they're not just trying to destroy Christianity by taking a battering ram and beating us over the head with it. They are using espionage. They're spying on us. And they are using subtle intelligence methods and deceiving many Christian pastors and so-called theologians and bringing Judaism into the Christian church. They are the Judaizers, the Gentiles, who are now preaching Judaism from the so-called Christian pulpit. Friends, across America today, rank, pure evil Judaism, Phariseeism is being taught. Turn on your television, Trinity Broadcasting Network, the James Dobson Focus on the Family show on radio, and many others are teaching Satanism in one of its purest forms, which the Apostle Paul said in Galatians 1 is an accursed gospel. And listen, you know, the Apostle Paul didn't repeat himself very much. But in Galatians 1, he says, I say to you again, if you teach this false doctrine, you will be accursed. Wow. What greater warning can a man receive? And yet that accursed gospel of the Pharisees is being taught in the guise of biblical Christianity across America and the world by the biggest named evangelists and preachers. I call this the revenge of the Pharisees. They're getting their revenge by having so-called Christian preachers teach Phariseeism. And we're exposing it here. Now, before we begin today's message, of course, we need your support. We need your tithes, your offerings. But do only as the Holy Ghost leads you, my friends. We'd love to hear from you. If you have a prayer need, would you let us know? We'll be honored to pray for your special needs. And I read every letter that comes in to Bible Home Church. I will personally read your letter, and I will personally pray for you. And it's an honor to do so. Now, we've got a beautiful song today. You know, I gave a little talk about Elvis Presley. I fully recognize he did not always lead his life as a Christian. His biographers say that he had at one time in his life accepted Jesus Christ as Lord. I hope that's true. Because God gave him a great gift, a great voice. And I know one thing that his biographers say. They say that he loved gospel music more than any other kind. I've heard the Rock and Roll Museum up in Cleveland, Ohio. One of the first ones they inducted into their museum was Elvis Presley. Some call him the father of rock and roll. They say that's a great legacy at the Rock and Roll Museum. But I don't think God would agree to that. It seems to me the greatest legacy that Elvis Presley left, and friends, there were bad role model things that he left behind, the drugs that he took, the women that he used, so many bad things that the sins that he committed. But there is a small legacy that he left behind that I believe is the only thing that's going to count. It's the songs he sang because he really believed deep down in his heart. I'm not saying his life showed it. I wish it had. I pray that on his deathbed, before he breathed his last breath, I hope he did accept Jesus Christ. I hope he repented for his sins. But I know one thing. They say that he invited gospel groups after his performances, and they would go privately together with him, and they would have big sing songs. And all he wanted to do was sing gospel songs. He didn't want to sing his favorites. You know, the ones that he had number one recordings that made all the hit parades. He said, let's sing about Jesus. Isn't that interesting? Something was pulling Elvis Presley. I wish he had answered that call. I wish he had thrown off all of the trappings of evil satanic culture and concentrated on this gospel music. What a legacy he would have left then. But he did perform some in the Christian realm. A good friend of the ministry, Spencer Allen Morris from Ohio, sent us an album of songs by Elvis Presley. And at first I said, you know, I'm not going to play this on the air, because Elvis Presley's lifestyle wasn't always positive for Jesus. But then I thought about it. I said, wait. You know, the Bible says that even Christians are some who leave really nothing behind of a legacy. They get into heaven, I mean, but everything else is burned up. All their works are burned up because they're of nothing. I thought about Elvis Presley. I don't know whether he is in heaven. I can't say that. God only can judge. But I want to tell you something. He did leave a small, maybe you think it's a tiny legacy, but he left some albums of gospel songs that he sang. I think they're worthy. You see, it's not always that the vessel is so perfect. But I believe these songs have the message of God in them. I'm going to continue playing some of these songs. If you want to criticize me, you can do that. But you know, some years ago, I had a man who seemed to be in the know. And I mentioned to him about some of my favorite gospel groups that sang. And he said, you know, if you were to get on the bus with those guys, and a lot of them had big buses, they would drive from crusade convention or from church to church. He said a lot of them drink on those buses, and they bring women into those buses, and they do terrible things. Then they go in those churches and pretend that they're gospel singers. And they wow their audiences and bring their audiences to tears. I asked this man, I said, are all of them like that? He said, a good many of them. I said, well, I don't know the names of the ones that are bad or the ones that are good. I'm going to let Jesus sort that out. But I'll tell you this much, I'm not going to throw out all the music. It could be that in our hymnals, not every person who wrote one of the great old hymns had a perfect prayer life, a perfect unspotted life. But do any of us have that? Who is the first one to cast a stone, dear friends? Now again, I'm going to play a song by Elvis Presley, perform Elvis Presley. Not to glorify Elvis Presley. I never do that here on this program. I've never glorified any of the people who sing, the so-called Christian entertainers. I've never, you know, made them paragons of virtue or excellence. Some of them I know are good Christians. Some of them I know are struggling to be good Christians. But I know this much, my friends. This song was anointed by God. Not as sung necessarily by Elvis, but the words and the music. It's entitled, How Great Thou Art. George Beverly Shea used to sing it so beautifully with his bass voice at those Billy Graham crusades. Somebody told me recently, well, you know what we know about Billy Graham now? It sort of makes those songs, it sort of takes away the glory of those songs. I said, no, listen, my friend. Listen, my friend. Sometime Billy Graham read from the Bible. Are we to criticize the Bible because of the man who brought the message and his life? Bill Clinton took his 5-pound Bible, big as all life, and he trotted over from the White House to the Foundry United Methodist Church on Easter Sunday. Had his Bible there for all to see, all the world to see. He was a Bible-carrying, Christian-believing president as he went to church on Easter morning. But all the time he was sitting in that church pew, he knew that when he returned back to the Oval Office on an Easter Sunday, waiting for him would be Monica Lewinsky, and that's when they did one of their dirtiest sex acts together that I'm not even going to discuss now on this show. That very history record, it was that very day when he took his Bible and all the cameras showed him going into that church with Hillary and Chelsea by his side, carrying that Bible in that church, and all the time Monica Lewinsky was waiting for him back in the Oval Office to do a dirty act when he got out of church. Now I want to tell you something, friends. Are we to blame the Word of God for what Bill Clinton did? No. I believe this song is an anointed song. Listen to the words of it. And I believe that Elvis Presley had a voice that was a gift from God, if only he had used it wholly. He did use it some. I'm proud of Elvis Presley that this tiny bit of his life is left as a legacy for us. I am not going to throw out this little bit of Elvis Presley or any other entertainer. Criticize his lifestyle all you want. You won't find argument with me. If you want to make a case that Elvis Presley is not in heaven today, you won't get an argument from me. I don't know. Let God judge. If you said, but look at his lifestyle, I would say you're absolutely right. By our standards, even God's standards, he doesn't deserve to go to heaven. But then, neither do I. are you? Here's Elvis Presley singing How Great Thou Art. And then right after that, we're going to have our continuing series, Revenge of the Pharisees. I'm Pastor Tex Morris, and I'm so delighted you're here with us today, part of our congregation at large of Bible Home Church. Clinton went there and she prayed and she put her little message in the crack in the wall. And George W. Bush went over there and he was escorted around by Ariel Sharon in Israel, and he vowed to kiss Sharon's feet, I'm sure. And he put his little note in there, and so did Bill Clinton. And so is almost every president except Ronald Reagan that we've recently had and Richard Nixon. The wall of Lucifer is what that is. It's not the wall of the temple. Did Jesus lie? I know the answer to that. And if you don't, if you want to believe it's the wall of the temple, then I laugh at you. Now listen to me very carefully. Today we're going to look at a situation that is developing. The Christian church is becoming Judaized. In fact, Christianity is becoming Judaism. You may not even know this. You may be going to church where you think you're studying Christianity because they mention things that are in the Bible. But I want you to understand that the Bible itself warns in the last days, warns about the religion to come. And the religion will be so unlike true Christianity, but yet the people in the pews won't even understand. The wise shall, Daniel 12, verse 10. Listen, Paul said to the Galatians, they already, even at the time of the Apostle Paul, these Jewish elements were seeking to destroy the Christian church through subversion. Why wouldn't they today? Do you think the Jewish religion has changed over the years? Have I not warned you again and again with tears about the Jewish Talmud that says that Mary was a whore who had sex with a Roman soldier and had an illegitimate child, a bastard named Jesus? That's in the Jewish Talmud, their holy book. And they hold it, the rabbis hold it higher than the Bible. And that's why Paul warned, don't go back into Judaism. Don't go back into the law. Don't accept Judaism into the Christian faith. Oil and water don't mix, friends. And the living waters of Jesus will extinguish the fire of Satan when the two meet. Listen, Paul warned in Galatians chapter 1. He said, I marvel that you are so soon removed from him that called you into the grace of Christ unto another gospel, or into another gospel. You see, already this church had already just been established in Galatia, and already the people were saying, maybe we ought to switch to the traditions of the Jews, the laws of the Jews. They already had Jews claiming to be Christians joining the Christian church, perverting it. And the Gentiles were buying it, eating it up. And Paul said, I marvel. He was amazed. There be some that trouble you and would pervert the gospel of Christ, he says in verse 7. But though we are an angel from heaven, preach any other gospel unto you than that which we have preached unto you, let him be accursed. Friends, I'm going to warn you right now, those of you who are joining in these messianic churches, and they have, even though Jesus said, don't call anybody master except the Father in heaven, they have as head of their congregation a rabbi, and they claim to be Christian. They're even developing the halakha, the law book. Many of them are studying the Talmud, and their entire Christian ministry is forming up. Many of them are led by Jewish so-called Christians, and they are not. They are Jewish Pharisees, and they're bringing the whole Christian church. Check this out in Christian bookstores. Book after book talking about messianic Christianity, returning Christianity to its Jewish roots. Jesus uprooted it from its Jewish roots and used Christianity to reconcile the whole world, used the Gentiles. But now in the last days, the book of Esther is about to be renewed, my friends. And I want to warn you, why don't you go and read what the Jews did in the book of Esther, and then the book that follows it in the Bible, you will find and discover to your horror that the book of Job follows right after Esther. The massacre of Gentiles is at hand. And first comes spiritual deception. In the book of Job, there are two great beasts, Behemoth and Leviathan. First comes Behemoth, and with his horrible snout, he draws up all the water. That's spiritual water. That's spiritual truth. And he makes of this earth a dry, parched desert. No wonder Amos said people will be so thirsty for the Word of God, they'll travel great distances just to hear the Word of God preached in the last days. Can't find it in a local church or congregation. Accursed. Verse 9, Paul said, as we said before, so say I now again. Hey, friends, if you didn't hear Paul in verse 8 when he said, if you believe in this messianic Judaism for the Christian churches are bringing into the traditions of the Jews, and I'm going to give you some of those traditions in just a minute, you'll be shocked.
You may be going along with these things and not even knowing it. Your next door neighbor might be into Messianic Judaism. He doesn't even call it that, but that's what he is into. It's Satanism. It's Satanism. And listen, Paul, in verse 8 here in Galatians, the first chapter, says, if you bring that into the church or bring it into your life, you're a cursed man. You are marked by God and cursed. It's bad enough just to be a reprobate. It's bad enough to be a sinner. But you got hope. But if you're accursed by God, I doubt if you've got any hope. But that's up to God. How rare is the man who is cursed by God, who shall enter the kingdom of heaven? Listen to me. Verse 9, the very next verse, Paul says it again. He doesn't repeat himself because he doesn't know how to speak well. Just like Jesus. If Jesus said something twice in a row, you think you better listen to it? Well, this is Jesus speaking, the Holy Ghost of Jesus speaking through Paul in Galatians. Verse 9 says, as we said before, so now I say again, if any man preach any other gospel unto you than that ye have received, let him be accursed. Twice in a row, Paul said, you will be cursed. How much more clear could it be? You say, well, was he talking about Phariseeism? Well, read it all for yourself. I don't have to read it for you. You'll find what he says. Now listen, he goes on in the book of Hebrews, very appropriately titled, the book of Hebrews, and talking about the covenant with the Jews. Many people say, oh, God never breaks his covenant. Oh, well, he wouldn't break that covenant. The covenant with the Jews still stands. If you're listening to Falwell and Robertson and Billy Graham and all the others, well, you got a problem. You got a problem with the Scriptures. If they tell you the covenant with the Jews will never be broken, you've got a problem with God's Scriptures. Chapter 8, verse 7, Hebrews. Paul writes, for if that first covenant had been faultless, there should no place have been sought for the second. The first covenant had faults in it. You mean God put faults in it? No, the Jewish people did. They wouldn't obey it. It became of none effect. So what did God say? Verse 8, he found fault with them. It says, for finding fault with them, that is the Jewish people, he saith, behold, the days come, saith the Lord, when I will make a new covenant with the house of Israel and with the house of Judah, not according to the covenant that I made with their fathers in the day when I took them by the hand and lead them out of the land of Egypt, because they continued not in my covenant. And I regarded them not. The Jews didn't continue in God's covenant, and God says, okay, I'm not going to have any regard for you. I'm going to cut you off too.
If you're thirsty and dry, look to the sky. It's beginning to rain.
You've been listening to Pastor Tex Mars and Bible Home Church. Please join with us in worship next week as we continue to honor the remarkable Word of God.
It's beginning to rain, rain, rain in the voice of our Father. Saying, whosoever will come to drink of this water, I promise to pour my Spirit out on your sons and your daughters. If you're thirsty and dry, look up to the sky. It's beginning to rain.
Hello, friends. This is Tex Mars, inviting you to worship with us today at Bible Home Church, coming to you from Austin, Texas.
Hello, friends. This is Tex Mars. Glad to have you back with us today as we continue to worship. And this is our congregation at large of Bible Home Church. And yes, you're invited to be a member of it. If you're listening right now, I consider you one of our brethren that are caring about the Word of God. And there's so few today that are. And we appreciate these things. You know, one of my great loves is Bible prophecy. And the Bible clearly shows that Jesus is that spirit of prophecy. That's from the book of Revelation. The very spirit of prophecy. Well, one of the things we know is that even the very Christian religion will be polluted in the last days. And he who comes as the beast of prophecy, Revelation 13, says he will appear to be like a lamb, but he'll have horns. Isn't that interesting? Have two horns. He'll speak like a dragon, but he will appear to be like a lamb. You know, the devil himself comes as an angel of light. And his ministers come as ministers, come disguised as ministers of righteousness. We're continuing our series then about the Pharisees, the religion of the Pharisees. A lot of people think they're just going over some academic exercise when they read Gospels such as Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, where it will teach you about the evil, polluted religion of the Pharisees and what Jesus had to say about them and their religious teachings. Many people say, well, that was for 2,000 years ago. It's only of passing historical interest to me. You are dead wrong. You see, the reason I believe that these accounts are in the Gospels are twofold. They not only chronicle what happened during that human lifespan, you might say, of Jesus Christ, our Lord and God, but these are a warning for our day. Every word in all of the New Testament is a testimony of the power of Jesus Christ. It's his story. But more than that, it's a prophetic significance to you and me. If you discover the horrible truth of the Pharisees in reading the Gospels, you will come to discover the horrible truth of the Pharisees operating today inside the Christian church. What a shock that is. What a handsome discovery, because it'll put you on the road to knowledge, to spiritual discernment and understanding. And did you know that the Bible says that one of God's greatest gifts is discernment and prophecy? Despise not prophesying, Paul said. Some people don't even believe in prophecy for today. I believe wholly, 100% in prophecy today, if it corresponds to the truth of the Bible. Oh, a lot of people just spout off things off the top of their head in these churches. And they speak in tongues and they have an interpreter. And both of them are just pretenders and fakes many times. There are people that I see claim to be prophets on TV, and all they do is have a parade of people come up to them and they prophesy over them. Like, they're like seers, like fortune tellers. They may as well get out their tarot cards or their tea leaves or cast lots. They may as well consult the odds makers at Las Vegas on what your life is going to be. Consult the astrologers and so forth. But I'm here to tell you that this Bible chronicles not only the past, all the way back to the beginning of mankind, and even before that, to your future and my future and the future of all of mankind. It's all right here in this great book, the Holy Bible. Now, a lot of people fault Tex Mars for a lot of different things. Even my wife Wanda every once in a while finds fault with me. I'm not sure, but it could be that some of my staff here have a few things to say about me, choice words. I don't know. I hope they like me. I love all of our staff here. They're my family. They're precious to me. But every once in a while, they may not like some of the things I do, or they may think I'm just foolish about some of my policies or whatever, or they think they could do it better. And, you know, maybe they could. I listen very closely to their suggestions and ideas, and sometimes they're better than mine.
In fact, it seems as I get older, their suggestions are a lot better than mine. So, and I have to sort of carve up mine and change them about and all that stuff. But there is one thing that I will never be faulted for. There is one thing that I am perfect on. Ah, that's right. My wife can't complain about it. I am absolutely perfect on this thing. And here it is. It's not any trick. It's not something hidden. I perfectly know that this Bible is the Word of God. It's true. It's without error. It's been preserved for you and me today. And we can take it in our hands. We can open it up and read it and trust that every word is God speaking through His prophets and the apostles and these writers. I know that, and I know that I cannot be faulted for saying that and preaching that and teaching that. Someday somebody may go over my life story. I don't really think it's significant enough for anybody. Don't waste your time on my life story. Don't write a biography about me. There might be somebody that does, and they might find some terrible things about me. In fact, I think about 40 years ago, one time I voted Democrat. I'm not sure. They may even dig that out. I can't remember who I voted for, but I think I voted Democrat because that was for the days they supported abortion and all the other stuff. That'd be a terrible rally. That's a skeleton in my closet right there. I've revealed 40 years ago voting Democrat in an election. I wouldn't do it again, I can tell you that. But listen, I've made mistakes. Not a lot of big ones. And that's why I'm writing about my life wouldn't be that juicy. I just don't have all the scandal that so many other Christian televangelists have and everything. It just, I mean, I'm sorry, but don't waste your time. I've never smoked pot. I've never been injected with heroin. I've never, taken cocaine. Don't know how it feels to do any of those things. Back in my, days before I got married, and, when I was a wild young Air Force officer type and all that, I probably drank a few more beers or drinks than I should at the officers club. Partied with the boys, just giving joking and talking and just foolishness. I look back now and it was just foolishness. You go with the pilots and all the others after work and, after a hard day on the flight line and you go out there and you just chat with them and party and talk and have fun and have drinks at happy hour and all that. Just wasting your time. That's all it was. Stupid. Spending a few dollars more than you needed to for alcohol that didn't do you one bit of good, clouded your mind. Just totally stupid. Now, if you're in that condition listening to me right now, you are a stupid person for doing that. How do I know? Because I did it back in my younger days. I was a stupid man. And then one day, God just sent me on a little journey, and He just took me by the nape of the neck and threw me down into the valley of despair and said, let me just show you what you are, who you are, and what you're supposed to be. He changed my life, friends. When you're down in that valley of despair, when you're in that wilderness, you look up and say, where's the light? What did I do wrong? Where am I to go now? And then you realize there is one who you can latch on to. There is one only who can rescue you. That happened to me one day. And that's when I gave up all that stuff. That's why you won't find much juicy stuff in my biography. You'll just find the normal sins. Anger, telling a fib here and there. Just on and on. None of which are good by any means. And I suppose in one sense, if you commit one sin, you've committed all of them until you're redeemed by Jesus Christ. And then those are all forgotten. That's why I'm not going to go back and dwell on those things. Why should I? Jesus said He would throw them in the sea of forgetfulness. What am I supposed to do? Go back and fish for them? Pretty stupid. You talk about being stupid. That would be the supreme idiocy. Don't let the devil remind you of your past. And if you do, say, well, devil, look at your future. That'll shut him up. But that's the one perfect thing that I've always done in this ministry. So I like that question. Tex, what have you done perfect in your ministry? Okay, here it is. I've always supported, endorsed, believed in, taught, preached that this Holy Bible is truly the Word of God. The King James Bible is 100% without error, preserved. God said He would preserve it, keep it pure. I don't believe that God lied. I know He did not lie. If you think He lied, well, you're in big trouble and you're the liar. I'm not going to go along with you. If you think you found errors, I've just had so many preachers that came up to me and said, you know, I love your supporting that King James Bible. There are a few errors in it, but not many. I have pastors that came up to me, boy, they're talking to the wrong guy and me. I tell them, oh, listen to me, friend. Listen, you're in bad territory. You're up against a warrior for Christ. And you need to do some study, and you're way off. You're in quicksand. This Bible is 100% without error. And if they don't watch out, I'll grab them by the nape of the neck, and I'll just teach them some things. I like to do that. You see, with all the other mistakes I've made in my life, I look back and say, this is the one good thing I've done. When Jesus gets me before the throne and says, why do you deserve to be here? And I don't exactly know what judgment day is going to be like, but it could be that. And He says, well, what have you done good for me? I'm going to say, well, Lord Jesus, I told everybody your Bible was 100% without error and it could be believed in and trusted. You know what? I expect to be rewarded for that. Now, I may be foolish, but I don't think so. I believe in this Bible. And if you believe in the Bible, you're going to believe in the one who wrote it, Jesus. And if you believe in Jesus, your sins will be forgiven you, and you're going to enter the kingdom of heaven. I like that. I'm going to tell Jesus that. That's my sermon to Jesus. And I'm going to tell Jesus, I'm standing on that, Lord. You can burn away all my other works. Maybe they didn't amount to anything. But this one work stands forever. And I think Jesus will probably just smile at me and say, yeah, you're right, Tex. That one thing stands. Along, of course, with the fact that on that particular day when you repented of your sins and gave your life to me. Those two things alone, and they both are linked together. You can't have one without the other. If a man does not know Jesus Christ as Lord but says, I believe in this Bible 100%, I don't believe in Him. And if a man says, I believe in Jesus, but I don't believe in this Bible 100%, I don't believe in Him. The two go together, hand in hand. Sort of like Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. You can't separate them. Benny Hinn wrote a book and he said, every morning I wake up and I say, good morning, Holy Spirit. That's pretty stupid. Because you can't separate the Holy Spirit from Jesus and the Father. I think he tried to do that. These strict Trinitarians take it to an extreme and say there are three persons. Well, first of all, God's not even a person. Now, if they want to call it something else, I'll go along with them. But three persons? For many years, I was in the Air Force chaplaincy, and they sang that old Lutheran song. God in three persons, blessed Trinity. And I sat there saying, wait just a minute. The Bible says God is a spirit, and you must worship Him in spirit and in truth. That's interesting, isn't it? These people are saying God is three persons. Is the Holy Spirit a person? I think not. That's pretty dumb. Not only is it dumb, it's not even correct. Now, you know, maybe some of them sitting in those pews didn't really mean it. Maybe Martin Luther didn't really mean it, although I'm afraid he might have. What do you think the Holy Spirit is going to look like when you get to heaven? Friends, let me tell you something. The Holy Spirit comes here, and He is a witness of Jesus. But it is a He. The Holy Spirit is not an it. That is true. He will testify of Jesus if it is truly of the Holy Spirit, because there is another spirit. He's the one, that false spirit that says, that Bible's not real. Jesus wasn't really who He said He is. You got to test the spirits, friend.
But there is one Holy Spirit, and he will testify to you that this Bible is real, and that's why Tex Mars is perfect in that one thing. I'd love to pray for you. It's just a thing I like to do. It's not a burden. It's not an onerous task. Let me pray for you. I get a blessing by praying for you. Don't deprive me of my blessing. So what is your problem, dear friend? Do you have a loved one that needs Jesus? Are you sick? Are you ill? Are you depressed? Are you disappointed about something in life? You want somebody to pray with you? I'll pray with you. And I'll say something else too. And I mean this. Here's the second thing I can be perfect in. See, I'm going to tell Juana when they get home all these things I found. You know, she'll want to know about those. The perfection in her husband, Tex. The second thing is God answers prayers. I know that's true. I'm going to stand on that because that's in the Bible. And the Holy Spirit that is in me testifies to that as true. I'm going to stand on that because that's two things I've been perfect in today. There's a lot more. I'm going to find a lot more. Probably before this sermon is over with today that I'm perfect in. But they're all things of God. See, they're nothing about me. I'm only involved when I trust in God. Otherwise, I'm imperfect. I have flaws. I have blemishes. But the minute that I latch onto this Bible and believe in it 100%, suddenly I'm perfect. Of course, you know, there are little imperfections in my flesh, but we won't talk about those things. Write to us. We'd love to hear from you. You know, you might just want to call and encourage us. You might want to call and say, I'm praying for your success, for your ministry, that it'll reach so many lost people in the world, that you'll get the truth out to a needy world. I'd like to hear from you. I like attaboys. On the other hand, you may not like some of what I've said, and you just say, dear Tex, I want you to know you're a jerk. Okay, I'll take it. I'll throw your letter in the trash. Probably won't pay much attention to it, but I'll read it. You'll at least know that I know that you said I was a jerk. I don't get many letters like that, but every once in a while I get worse letters than that, actually, sometimes. So, you know, it's always nice to know how many people out there think I'm a jerk. Not many do, really. I'm amazed. I always say when I haven't been getting a lot of hate mail, I know I'm not doing enough for God. So I need to accelerate my teachings a little bit, you know. Get into the deep meat of the Word, you know. That's when you really get the hate mail. That's when I like it. That's when my blood boils and I'm getting, ooh. I get to be a fanatic then. I am a fanatic about things. And the more letters that blast me for sticking by this Bible, if I stick by this Bible and they bash me and they hate me, I love it. I love it. It invigorates me to get those kind of letters. Text, you're a jerk. Oh, wonderful. Praise God. Splendid letter today. Okay. We're not going to have a song today, but we have just a little bit of time left. We're going to talk about the revenge of the Pharisees. Folks, watch out for the Judaizers. They're Pharisees. They're part of the Pharisee movement. You need to know about them. Here, again, is our series, a portion of it, Revenge of the Pharisees. Friends, listen to me. Here it is. Verse 10 says, for this is the covenant that I will make with the house of Israel. That's you. You, if you're a Christian, you are the house of Israel. How do I know that? Galatians also says so. If ye are Christ, then are you Abraham's seed and heirs to the promise, the covenant promise. But as for the Jews, they're cut off. They're whacked off. How can they get back in? By accepting Jesus. But they despise, hate, and loathe Jesus and his children. He won't let them in. He won't let them back in. Why should he? Listen to verse 13. In that he saith, that's God, in that he saith, a new covenant. He made the first old. Now that which decayeth and waxeth old is ready to vanish away. Wow! He made a new covenant. They wouldn't obey the first one. So he cut them off. Now he has a new covenant. He puts it in people's hearts. You're born again. You have a new heart. You're circumcised in the heart. But there's that other group.
in Revelation, it's called the synagogue of Satan. The synagogue of Satan. The synagogue of Satan. And they say, we believe in the old covenant of Abraham. We will not have this new man, this King Jesus, rule over us. Kill him. Kill his disciples. What does God say? A new covenant. He saith a new covenant. He made the first old. Decayed. Waxeth old. Vanish. Wow. Well, what are we to do about all of those Jewish festivals? What are we to do about all the meats and the drinks you're supposed to eat and the washing you're supposed to do and all the ordinances that have been imposed? What are we to do? What about Rosh Hashanah and Yom Kippur and Purim and all of those things? Ah. Verse 10 of chapter 9 of Hebrews talks about those which stood only in meats and drinks and diverse washings and carnal ordinances imposed on them until the time of reformation. God imposed ordinances on the Jews, not for eternity, friends. That would be stupid. When Jesus came, I mean, the reason for those ordinances, the reason for those festivals and holy days was over. He was the reason. The time of Reformation. These were only effective until the time of Reformation. But wait, verse 11 then says, but Christ, being come a high priest of good things to come by a greater and more perfect tabernacle, not made with hands. Verse 12 says, neither by the blood of goats and calves, but by his own blood he entered in once into the holy place, having obtained eternal redemption for us. Verse 15 says, and for this cause he is the mediator of the new Testament. And what happens to those who believe in the New Testament and who are covered by this new covenant, the New Testament? It says that they which are called might receive the promise of eternal inheritance. Wow. The Jewish covenant, listen to me, is dead, dead, dead as a doornail. It's old. Decayed, banished. But don't worry about it. Jesus created a new covenant. He is the mediator. There is only one mediator between man and God. That mediator is not the Jewish Talmud. It's not the Jewish Kabbalah. It's not the Jewish Halakha, the law. It is Jesus Christ. And if ye be Christ, then are ye Abraham's seed and heirs to the promise. You say, but wait. Don't you think we ought to have the Passover and the Rosh Hashanah and all of the Jewish things? I mean, I do that as a Seventh-day Adventist. I do that as a Baptist. I do that as a Messianic Jewish Christian. Well, then you're an idiot and you're a fool and you're not paying attention to the Word of God. Let's go to the Word of God. Don't listen to text, Mars. I can be a fool just like you. But I believe in the Word of God. That makes me a little bit wiser if you believe in something else, such as your church or denomination's teaching or your pastor's teachings. I don't trust myself. Every morning when I wake up, I look in the mirror and say, Lord, let your Word be my lamp today to guide me. That's all I want. I don't want to serve myself. I want to serve God. Do you want to serve God? Then listen to this. Verse 9, chapter 4 of Galatians. Let's start with verse 6. I want to make sure you have the Spirit of God in your heart, or you're not going to receive this. Do you hear what I said? The natural man receiveth not the things of God. If you don't have the Spirit of God, you're going to say, Tex, you're a liar. It doesn't matter if I read the scriptures. I can read them 100 times. You'll still say, that cannot be true. I've been taught otherwise. So I'm going to start with verse 6. It says, and because ye are sons, God hath sent forth the Spirit of His Son into your hearts, crying, Abba, Father. Are you the Son of God? Do you have the Spirit of God? Then receive this, my friends. Verse 7 says, Wherefore thou art no more a servant, but a son. And if a son, then a heir of God through Jesus Christ. Not through the Jews are you an heir. Not through the Old Testament. Not through anything but Jesus Christ are you a heir, an heir of God. Did you just get it, friends? Don't try to say, Israel, return to the roots. Return to our Israeli roots. Return to the Talmud. Return to the Halakha. Baloney!
If you're thirsty and dry, look to the sky. It's beginning to rain.
You've been listening to Pastor Tex Mars and Bible Home Church. Please join with us in worship next week as we continue to honor the remarkable Word of God.